Well, I'm not an expert on the Constitution, but Darlene asked me to speak, and I really appreciate that, and appreciate your patience. What I'm going to say is basically from my own understanding and my own research, and I hope it challenges you to either agree with me or try to prove me wrong. My discussion is about the Virginia Constitution, and in my opinion, though, the real issue we're facing today is our liberty, because that's what's being threatened. And I believe that a confrontation with evil and tyranny is directly ahead of us. You can look at what's going on in our country today, and I believe you'll agree with me on that. We have an enemy, but before the enemy can be engaged, he has to be identified. This enemy that we have today is not from outside. It's within our midst, perhaps within our own government, our churches, and perhaps even in our own families. We must know who the enemy is before we can even plan a strategy on how to defend ourselves against it. Going back in our history, the colonists knew the enemy. He was King George III. I'd like to give you three quotes from the Declaration of Independence. Quote, "He has abdicated government here by declaring us out of his protection and waging war against us, and for taking away our charters, abolishing our most valuable laws, and altering fundamentally the forms of our government. We must, therefore, acquiesce in the necessity which denounces our separation and hold them, as we hold the rest of mankind, enemies in war, in peace friends." The king had withdrawn his protection from the colonies. In essence, we had no law, we had no government. Our army was in the field being led by perhaps the greatest Virginian in our history of outstanding leaders and statesmen. Our General Washington was doing what had to be done to the enemies of the sovereign people. And our Virginia Constitution was a step that had to be taken. Our founders had no desire to be lawless. They had experienced tyranny up close, firsthand. We must have law. There must be rules. The Virginia Constitution is our law, the foundation of our commonwealth and our system of government. Now, the Constitution was not written to define our rights and our liberty, because we have all the rights and all the liberty as a gift, a birthright from God, our Creator. The Constitution was written to define the duties of the government and to contain the government, as Article 1, Section 2 of the Virginia Constitution states. All power is vested in and consequently derived from the people, that magistrates are their trustees and servants, and at all times amenable to them. The original Virginia Constitution in 1776 was the foundation, what Virginia was built upon. Psalms 11:3 asks this question: "If the foundations be destroyed, what can the righteous do?" Well, I want to pose the question: have our foundations been destroyed? And I say that if we, the citizens of Virginia, us in this room, if we do nothing else, a thorough study of Virginia's Constitution and Virginia's history is vital to understanding where we are and how we deal with our liberty. The Virginia Constitution has been updated 6 times since the original. Well, really, we have 2 separate Virginia Constitutions. The original, from 1776, was slightly changed in 1830, and again in 1851. Originally, only property owners could vote. Only people with a real stake in the system had an opportunity to change the system. Ultimately, though, by 1851, all male citizens over 21 years of age could vote. And you gotta remember, Virginia was a huge area, at least all the way to the Ohio River. It's a huge area. That was basically the original Constitution. Now, all of these constitutions are available online, and I would encourage you to go and just take a look at each one of them. All the updates are there. Then we have the second Virginia Constitution, or as I would like to say, the second Virginia Constitution. There was a lot of controversy, of course, during the war years when West Virginia was made into a state, and in my opinion, that was unlawful. A constitution was written for Virginia by the government of West Virginia in 1864. Of course, West Virginia had been part of Virginia. Virginia refused to recognize this, and so that constitution was of no effect. After the war in 1868, when Virginia, along with all the other southern states, refused to ratify the 14th Amendment to the U.S. Constitution, the South was placed under Reconstruction. And by decree of Congress, were outside the Union and could only be readmitted by agreeing to the 14th Amendment to the U.S. Constitution and ratifying a new Virginia Constitution that was satisfactory to the radical Congress. This is where the foundations, in my opinion, of the original Virginia Constitution were dismantled. The U.S. Constitution in Article 4, Section 4, guarantees to every state a republican form of government, not a democracy, a republican form of government. The U.S. Constitution in Article 1, Section 3 states, the Senate of the U.S. shall be composed of two senators from each state. U.S. Constitution Article 5 states, no state without its consent shall be deprived of equal suffrage in the Senate. Without its consent. Now, in my study of the U.S. Constitution, I have not found the authority of Congress to take away the statehood of Virginia, change us into a territory. But that's exactly what happened under Reconstruction. Virginia became Region 1 under the command of General John Schofield. I'm diverting a little bit here to the U.S. Constitution because it's important to make the point, so just bear with me. This 14th Amendment to the U.S. Constitution, we'll just briefly look at it. It's important. Under the 14th Amendment, anyone in any of the states of the former Confederacy could be prohibited from voting in any election, but the, quote, right to vote could not in any way be denied to any other male inhabitant. The U.S. Constitution read that. This meant that former slaves could vote, and so could the Northern soldiers in the Army of Occupation. So could the carpetbaggers, all the federal civilian employees that were sent here, the adventurers, the swindlers, and the speculators from the North, along with those from many other foreign lands who flocked to the South to seek private fortunes. They were protected by the Army of Occupation. Anyone who had ever held a job requiring him to take an oath to the U.S. Constitution, but had later participated in the Confederacy, could never again hold any federal or state job, civil or military, unless Congress, quote, removed such disabilities. In the Constitution that came out of this, the 1870 Constitution, radicals in the Congress, led by Judge John Curtis Underwood, dominated this convention. And the resulting Constitution, the 1870 Virginia Constitution, became known as the Underwood Constitution. Judge Underwood was the presiding judge for Virginia. He was actually a native of New York City, and he was a Tammany Hall politician. He was appointed by Mr. Lincoln as a judge. Significant provisions And the Underwood Constitution included establishing a state school system with mandatory funding and attendance. That was not in the original. But it is one of the 10 planks of the Communist Manifesto. This constitution provided that judges would be elected by the General Assembly rather than by popular vote. So we couldn't choose our own judges. We the people. Clauses in this document continued to disenfranchise former Confederate government members. This Underwood Constitution was ratified by a popular vote of 210,585 to 9,136. It went into effect in 1870. Now, who do you think voted for this? Certainly not white property-owning Southern men. Where in the Constitution can anyone lose their citizenship by government decree? Well, faced with the positive failure of the 14th Amendment, both houses of Congress passed this over the veto of the president. Three acts known as the Reconstruction Acts between the dates of March 2nd, July 19th, 1867. This is an interesting little side trip. These acts, especially the Third Act, designed illegally to remove with military force the lawfully constituted state legislatures of 10 southern states. Now, in President Andrew Johnson's veto of the Reconstruction Act, he pointed out these unconstitutionalities. Quote, this is from the congressional record. If ever the American citizen should be left to the free exercise of his own judgment, it is when he is engaged in the work of forming the fundamental law under which he is to live. That work is his work, and it cannot properly be taken out of his hands. All of this legislation proceeds upon the contrary assumption that the people of each of these states shall have no constitution except such as may arbitrarily be dictated by Congress and formed under the restraint of military rule. A plain statement of facts makes this evident. In all of these states, the 10 southern states, there are existing constitutions framed in the accustomed way by the people. Congress, however, declares that these constitutions are not, quote, loyal and Republican, and requires the people to form them anew. What then is the opinion of Congress? Is necessary to make the constitution of a state loyal and Republican? The original act answers the question. It is universal Negro suffrage, a question which the federal constitution leaves exclusively to the states themselves. All of this legislative machinery of martial law, military coercion, political disenfranchisement is avowedly for that purpose and none other. The existing constitutions of the 10 states conform to the acknowledged standards of loyalty and republicanism. Indeed, if there are degrees in republican forms of government, their constitutions are more republican now than when these states, four of which were members of the original 13, first became members of the Union, end quote. Well, Virginia lived for 30 years, nearly a generation, with the Underwood Constitution. But by the 20th century, the Jim Crow laws had taken root in the South, and six southern states had already disenfranchised the blacks. The 1901 Virginia Constitutional Convention met during this climate. Restricting voting rights, while not violating the 15th Amendment of the U.S. Constitution or disenfranchising any poor whites, was the basis of this convention. Under the leadership of Carter Glass, this was accomplished by creating requirements of literacy tests and poll taxes. Provisions of this 1902 Constitution abolished the county court system. It included the requirement of racial segregation in schools. It also created the State Corporation Commission to regulate the growing power of the railroads. That's a fascinating story in itself. This convention refused to honor its pledge that the Constitution would be put up to popular vote. And just like the 1864 Constitution, the 1902 Constitution was adopted without ratification of the electorate. But it ended up being in effect longer than any other Virginia Constitution. Today, the national government ignores our law pretty much, does whatever it wants. Their power to do this is derived from the 14th Amendment. As amendments are passed by the U.S. Constitution, the newer ones supersede the older ones. Section 1 of the 14th Amendment concludes with the Due Process Clause and the Equal Protection Clause. Let me explain these a little bit. If a state law imposes a heavier tax on whiskey than it does on milk, then the buyers of the products do not have equal protection. If a state law validates a will that leaves more money to one woman than to her sister, this law is not giving equal protection to both women. Nor is it giving equal protection to anyone else who are getting nothing from the will. Does that sound ridiculous? Well, we can totally rely on the Supreme Court to use common sense, can't we? This Due Process Clause of the 14th Amendment was copied from the 5th Amendment of the U.S. Constitution. The Due Process Clause had been in nearly every state constitution from the beginning. It's an ancient phrase from English law. By copying the Due Process Clause from the 5th Amendment, the 14th Amendment forced federal due process rules onto the state. This permits federal court review of a state court case determining the rules of due process. The Slaughterhouse Cases from around 1873 or so was the first case under the 14th Amendment due process law to reach the Supreme Court. In that case, the court rules that misuse of the 14th Amendment was being done intentionally by persons attempting to centralize, quote, in the hands of the federal government, large powers hitherto exercised by the states. And that this would, quote, transfer the security and protection of all civil rights to the federal government and bring within the powers of Congress the entire domain of civil rights heretofore belonging exclusively to the states. And would, quote, constitute this Supreme Court a perpetual censor upon all legislation of the states with authority to nullify such as it did not approve. Case by case, over time, the court has accepted some very strange arguments, and they have helped to convert the federal government, I would say, into a quasi-dictatorship over the people and the states. It was never meant in the original that the court would have the final say on what our laws are in Virginia. We the people have made the law, the Constitution. The 24th Amendment, Civil Rights Act of 1964, the Voting Rights Act of 1965, and a series of Supreme Court decisions, beginning with Brown versus Board of Education, had struck down most of the controversial aspects of the 1902 Virginia Constitution. The provisions restricting voting by blacks and the mandated segregation were gone. All of this, combined with the election of Governor Mills Godwin in 1965, created an impetus for government change. Godwin advocated the loosening of the constitutional restrictions of state-issued bonds and borrowing, and he used his popularity to forge a new constitution. In 1968, a joint resolution of the Virginia General Assembly approved a new commission, chaired by former Governor Harrison, to revise the Virginia Constitution. The proposed Constitution was overwhelmingly approved by the voters of Virginia and took effect July 1st, 1971. That's the Constitution we have in Virginia today. A couple of quotes here from Virginia Article 1. It was the Virginia Declaration of Rights originally in 1776. It's now Article 1. Article 1, Section 6 says that, quote, all elections ought to be free, and that all men, having sufficient evidence of permanent common interest with and attachment to the community, have the right of suffrage, and cannot be taxed, or deprived of, or damaged in their property for public uses without their own consent, or that of their representatives duly elected, or bound by any law to which they have not, in like manner, assented for the public good. Well, in my opinion, just like King George III, our national government, in a lot of ways, have, quote, taken away our charters, abolished our forms of government, and fundamentally altered the government of the states. And from my perspective, the national government, in a lot of ways, is usurping the liberty of all the sovereign people in the state. It's a big problem. So what do we do as citizens? Our duty is what we do. Article 1, Section 15 of the Virginia Constitution says that no free government or the blessings of liberty can be preserved to any people but by a firm adherence to these five principles: justice, moderation, temperance, frugality, and virtue. By frequent recurrence to fundamental principles, and by the recognition by all citizens that they have duties as well as rights, and that such rights cannot be enjoyed save in a society where law is respected and due process is observed. Thank you.